Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all for coming in to welcome to the Global Energy Center at the Atlantic Council. Really excited that you could all join us in this great panel to talk about the Southern Gas Corridor. I'm Tom Cunningham, the Deputy Director here. I'll just give a few quick words and then get out of the way. So the Southern Gas Corridor has been hugely important in transatlantic relations, in European energy security and gas supply diversification, and as a way for Azerbaijan to access global markets. And it's been a project that's been in the making for years. We've seen a lot of momentum very recently, starting with the selection of the route of the Trans-Adriatic Pipeline over Nabucco in 2013, and major groundbreakings in Azerbaijan in 2014, Turkey in 2015, and Greece in 2016. But what's the status today? And there's questions given what's going on in global energy markets and in geopolitics with regard to the status. Will it be completed on track in 2019-2020? What's the status of local opposition along the route? So what's the status of actual construction? Will it really help with energy security in Europe, particularly in the parts of Europe that suffer the most from a lack of diversification? Will the diversification be sufficient, given it will bring 10 BCMA initially, when European demand is expected to be nearly 500 BCMA. This is a billion cubic meters per year. And given Europe's gas market seems to be flat and is projected to remain so, and what else is going on in the neighborhood? What are the implications of Turkey-Russia rapprochement on the pipeline and on the European gas market that it would feed? To talk about this issue, we've got an amazing panel. We've got Dr. Anya Grigas, one of our non-resident senior fellows at the Dina Patricio Eurasia Center here at the Atlantic Council. We have Joe Murphy, who is the BP Vice President for the Southern Corridor, visiting us from Baku. We have Dan Stein, former senior advisor to the Special Envoys for Eurasian Energy Security and for the coordinator and Special Envoy for International Energy Affairs. He's worked for Ambassador Morningstar, Ambassador Carlos Pascual, Special Envoy Amos Hochstein. I used to work with him. He's taught me everything I know, so you'll find his expertise incredible. Which leads us to Ambassador Morningstar, who is the smartest, most handsome, nicest boss you could ever hope for. No, but seriously, Morningstar is great to be on this. He's a moderator, but I think you'll find him as sort of an extra panelist because you can't beat his expertise either. Having been ambassador to Azerbaijan in 2012 to 2014, special envoy for Eurasian Energy before that, he's been the ambassador to the European Union and ambassador and special advisor to the president on assistance to newly independent states of the former Soviet Union. So, got a great lineup here, and boss, I'll let you kick it off.
Well, thank you, Tom, and it is a particular pleasure for me to be doing this because along with Dan Stein, I've worked on these issues going back to the 90s, and so there's nothing I like talking about more and being involved in more than dealing with the Southern Corridor and Caspian issues, but I'll try and refrain to some extent anyway and let our panelists do most of the talking. So I'll start by asking Joe a very, very simple question, since you're involved, Joe, in the day-to-day operations of what's happening beginning in, you know, from Baku and dealing with the Shah Deniz project to the TANAP pipeline going through Turkey to the Trans-Adriatic pipeline. You're really the point man for the entire project. And so I'll ask you a simple question. So what's happening?
Sure. Well, thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I was remembering as I came here today that the first time I spoke to the Atlantic Council was in November 2014 in Istanbul. Right. And at that time, I was 3 months into the job, and I came to the Atlantic Council and confirmed to everybody that we were on track for the Southern Corridor. Now, 2 years later, and nearly 3 years into the project, I can reconfirm we're still on track. We are on schedule, we are safely delivering the project, and we will come in under budget. We're in construction in all of the countries along the Southern Corridor. All six countries, we have formally started construction. And we remain on schedule for first gas in the Caspian in the second half of 2018, and first gas into Europe in early 2020. I do want to give you the clear facts, and I will answer your question, Dick. I could be more succinct, but I want to build to the crescendo to lay out some of what's involved in this project. And let's remember the scale and scope of this project, because that's important in line with what's being delivered. So it's made up of a series of four mega projects, $45 billion of investment, four mega projects. Chardonnays in Azerbaijan, SCPX in Azerbaijan and Georgia, TANAP through Turkey, and TAP through Greece, Albania, and landing in Italy. It's an energy project with strategic importance. It brings about diversification of gas into Europe, and it brings a completely new source of gas. The infrastructure is scalable. So to address the question earlier, the infrastructure is scalable. We can increase it from 16 to 32 BCMA. Most important, this is a project driven by Azerbaijan and by SOCAR, the oil company, but it is also driven by all of the companies involved and the countries along on the project line. They work together very closely to deliver this. So now let's talk about the actual project itself in terms of delivery. Chardonnays 2 in Azerbaijan and in Georgia encompasses 26 subsea wells, 500 kilometers of subsea infrastructure, two bridge link platforms, and expansion to the existing Sangashel terminal, which is the biggest gas terminal outside of the Middle East. And it brings approximately 500 kilometers of new pipeline in Azerbaijan and Georgia. It's a total capital investment of $28 billion, and we've already committed $15 billion. I'm pleased to say, as of the end of this year, we will be 80% complete for the project Chardonnays and SCPX, 80% complete including engineering, procurement, and construction. We've got 27,000 people working on the project in Azerbaijan and Georgia at the current time, and we are on track and on budget. Okay. For TANAP in Turkey, this is operated by SOCAR, and I'm pleased to say that for the fantastic news for the largest part of the pipeline itself, 1,800 kilometers, we are on schedule for the middle of 2018 to link into the SCPX pipeline. The construction of the 56-inch pipeline is ongoing in three lots throughout Turkey. And around 700 kilometers of pipe have already been welded, with 800 kilometers of pipe strung out across the country itself. Schedule is always going to be a challenge in a pipeline of this description through this geography, but working with SOCAR, working with BOTAŞ and BP, then we'll manage that schedule. TAP, I'm delighted to say that as of August, construction started in Albania and in Greece, physical construction started in Albania and Greece, and early works started in Italy. The formal work in Italy will due to start in November of this year. TAP's a brand new company and has been working very hard to deal with land acquisition and permitting issues in Europe, which is in a catastrophic sort of change throughout the last two or three years. You remember what's going on in Greece, remember what's going on all across Europe. So TAP have been challenged by that, but they've risen to the challenge, and they're working well to progress this project. The key would be the ongoing timely approval of permits, primarily in all three countries, but primarily in Italy, which will allow this to meet the schedule. The schedule remains on first gas in January 2020, but that is challenged by permitting issues, and we'll need to continue to work to deliver that. Finally, I hope I didn't come across complacent in any way. There's huge technical challenges and huge political challenges still to be met in delivery of this project. There's an awful long way to go, and this project is only as strong as its weakest link. We've got to continue to manage the governments, the partners, the buyers. We've got to manage this mega project delivery in terms of schedule, safety, and cost. Many thanks.
Let me ask you, Joe, if you had to, explain what you think, and I know you're very positive about the outcome, and I think most of us are, but let's say the three biggest issues you're facing now, what would they be?
Three biggest issues. First issue would be obtaining regional permits in Italy. There's a landing point confirmed in the south of Italy, and to start the onshore construction, you need national and regional permits. and there is some ongoing political wranglings within Italy which are delaying the delivery of those regional permits. And that could have an impact on schedule. Land acquisition in Greece and Albania will always remain a challenge. In Greece alone, there's 10,100 parcels of land that need to be acquired to be able to build this pipeline. Interestingly enough, a little aside if I may, first of all, we signed a lot of contracts, but the owners of the land didn't want us to pay them for the contracts because they didn't want money in Greek banks. We then actually, the banking crisis improved slightly, and then all of the lawyers in Greece went on strike for 6 months. So none of the contracts could actually be signed. So those are that's a sort of a lighthearted way of looking at land acquisition. And then I think the third biggest risk would be if we get overtaken by any potential technical delays, whether it be in Azerbaijan, Georgia, Turkey, or any of the other European countries.
And before turning to Anya, maybe you could explain further why it's been quite significant, but my understanding, why have the costs come in so far under budget, for example, on TANAP?
Yes.
I think that's where you're getting the most benefit. And what effect, at the same time, what effect does the lower price of gas have on the commerciality of the project?
Sure. So there are cost reductions in Chardonnay's SCPX and in TANAP, and you're rightly saying that TANAP is probably the most dramatic cost reduction. I think that's because TANAP started placing contracts and procurement process right as the oil price dropped, and there was a deflationary piece within the market, so they could absolutely work hard with managing the supply chain in Turkey. TANAP have also kept very much the supply chain and all of the resources Turkey-focused and have driven very competitive rates. Equally, in Chardonnay's and SCPX, we've had less interruption in delivering than we thought, and we've also managed some of our contractors and the deflationary environment to the point where we can see cost savings in the delivery. Each quarter that you deliver this project, you're driving risk out of the project, and you can take provision out of the project, costs, etc. In terms of the economics, very different environment now to the environment when we signed the contract or final investment decision back in December 2013. And of course, this is the low oil price brings pressure on all of the partners who are contributing to pay for this project. You know, all of the partners feel the pinch when oil price has been dropped so dramatically. But if we continue to deliver on time, if we continue to deliver reducing the budget, then the project will be economic.
What about the price of gas? Are those set by the contracts that you have to purchasers, or is that something you're going to have to renegotiate? Or
no,
is it...
we have 25 years of gas sales agreement in place underpinning the 16 BCMA that's sold across the Southern Corridor. And those those contracts have separate sort of deals within them linked to oil price, et cetera. There's not going to be a renegotiation of those.
Okay. Let me go to Anya. Let's talk a little bit about the geopolitics. What's changed over the last year or two, or even over the last several months? You know, we have the Russian-Turkish rapprochement. Possibilities of Turkish Stream, other possibilities. There may be other issues you want to bring up. Talk to us a little bit about how you see the geopolitics.
Well, the geopolitical significance of this project of the Southern Gas Corridor has really changed, and it has always meant different things for the different actors involved, for the European Union, for Russia, for the Caspian gas producers. It has particularly changed, I would say, in the last 5 years in two different arenas, in two different ways. So first, we have to consider the changes in the natural gas markets. Really, since the 2010s, we're in a very different market environment. We have a gas glut. We have gas prices are going down. There's new sources of gas right now. We have U.S. becoming a gas exporter due to the U.S. shale revolution. We have a rise in global LNG trade. We've had more interconnections on the European continent, infrastructural interconnections. We now have reverse flow of gas and so on. So basically, these have created a type of more buyer's market and more favorable conditions for importing states. So this, in a way, reduces maybe this somewhat the strategic importance of the Southern Gas Corridor in a way that it was perceived to bring diversify Europe's gas imports. But now, complete on the other hand, we've seen the political developments, and they point to something else. Since really 2014, we've had a significant deterioration of relations between Russia and the West. We have a conflict in Ukraine, and Ukraine is the key territory through which Russian pipe gas arrives to Europe. We have tensions in the Middle East. So these tensions raise the significance of the Southern Gas Corridor as a potential new source and a new route to diversify both sources and routes of Europe's gas imports. Now, if you look at these three different actors, and again, I said the project means different things to them. For Europe, the Southern Gas Corridor has been part of its broader both regulatory and other policy initiatives to diversify and to reform the European energy market. I mean, it's a significant infrastructural project, but it falls in line with other efforts like the third energy package or the single EU energy market, even the Commission's antitrust case against Gazprom. For Russia, today, which it's feeling kind of a squeeze both in these political and market conditions that I described, the southern, southeast Europe, and this is where the Southern Gas Corridor will arrive, remains a key battleground. This is where they would like to maintain their monopoly over those markets, the Southeast European markets. Russia and Gazprom have made some concessions already in Europe in terms of eliminating destination clauses and being more open to spot trade rather than long-term contracts. But Southeast Europe is one place where they will, I think, continue to fight for their position. And we can see that from their competing Turkish Stream project. So the project that's intended to bring Russian gas into Southeast Europe. And we've seen now the current, again, as the ambassador mentioned, rapprochement between Turkey and Russia and questions whether this project will be implemented and to what extent. Maybe the market conditions are not so favorable, but again, Russia is trying to hold on to this important market. And now for the Caspian producers, and really here I'm foremost speaking of Azerbaijan, but potentially Central Asian producers like Turkmenistan could further down the line also supply gas. For these countries, I think the changed market conditions and availability of a variety now of gas sources on the markets somewhat reduces their significance. I call them in my new book isolated suppliers because they're landlocked countries. So in a way, their only way for them to enter global gas markets is through pipeline infrastructure. They cannot enter the LNG markets, for instance. And for countries like Turkmenistan or maybe even Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan, well, from when this project was first conceived or when its predecessor of Nabucco was conceived, they were potentially very interested in the European markets. But since then, now they export to China and Asia, so they have secured new markets themselves. Of course, they would be happy to have access to more markets, but they don't have a dire need, let's say, to export to Europe. They're just trying to keep up with Chinese demand. So that's a quick overview, and we can touch on more questions.
Let me just follow up, with two questions and then turn it to Dan. When you talk about changing, obviously the gas markets have changed, in the last 5 or 6 years. You heard Joe say, yeah, but we've got contracts and, they're 25 years out. We're not so worried about it. What's your reaction to that, number one? An unrelated point, I guess. You mentioned Turkish Stream. There's the Turkish-Russian relationship. There's the Azerbaijan-Russian relationship. Do you see either of those having any effect on interference with Shah Deniz and the southern corridor? I'll leave it at that.
On the relationship between Russia and Turkey and Russia and Azerbaijan. So this market, as I said, the Southeast Europe market is very important for Russia, and it's been trying to woo both Azerbaijan and Turkey. Implementation of the Turkish Stream would be a great win for Russia. Now, in terms of, I think Azerbaijan is certainly interested in exporting to the European markets. In terms of Turkey needs gas. It would like to get gas both from Russia. It would like to get gas from Azerbaijan. It would like to get gas from wherever else it could. So I think there's some pragmatism in that relationship. In terms of your first question about the gas markets, certainly the changed gas markets don't threaten the southern gas corridor. The contracts are in place, and this is a long-term project. Pipeline infrastructure projects are long-term visions. Not something that's, you are reacting to day-to-day in market conditions, but the significance of that gas in these market conditions, I would say, is lower. It's lower because, first of all, we're talking about small amounts, the 10 BCM versus Europe's overall needs, but also the fact that Europe today, Spain and Portugal has received US LNG deliveries this year. There's this view, at least in the market now, that there are other potential options as well. But the Southern Gas Corridor is particularly unique because it's the sole pipeline infrastructure project bringing non-Russian gas.
I would just add on the geopolitical side, Turkish Stream, on the Turkish-Russian relationship in particular, that as long as Azerbaijan is committed to the Southern Corridor, I don't see Turkey interfering with that, given the relationship between Turkey and Azerbaijan. And as you mentioned, at least for the first 10 BCM going to Europe, even if, and I'm not sure how likely Turkish Stream ultimately is to happen, but even if it were to happen, there'd be plenty of room for that gas going to Italy, at least with respect to the first part of the project. But let me go to, just my own view. Dan, we've been working on this. I first went into the government the first time in 1993, and I've worked with Dan in all my years in the government, and we worked very closely going back to Baku, Tbilisi, Ceyhan, and then again when I was special envoy for Eurasian Energy. Talk a little bit about why do we care? We've been on a bipartisan basis for 20 years. We've been consistently supporting whether it's either Baku, Tbilisi, Ceyhan, or the Southern Gas Corridor. Why? Why do we care? Are we still there?
Yeah, I think in the 90s, in the mid-90s, when the U.S. first started to support the idea of an east-west energy corridor, which was really an idea, a vision of Georgian President Shevardnadze. And his idea was it wasn't so much related specifically to European energy security, which is what we talked about in terms of the Southern Gas Corridor. It was more bringing the linkage of the Caspian countries to the west, to Europe, bringing Azerbaijan, Georgia, Turkey, moving in the westward direction. And actually, at that time, the initial concept for a Southern Gas Corridor was 1997, 1998, when the idea was that the gas that would come into Turkey and then onto Europe would come from Turkmenistan across the Caspian through the Trans-Caspian gas pipeline. You have to remember, in 1997, 1998, Azerbaijan didn't know that it had any gas. And it was mainly an oil play, right? And so the idea was that Azerbaijan could be a transit country, bringing this gas from Central Asia to Georgia, Turkey, and on to Europe, and link those countries along the chain more in the European direction. Of course, we know what happened. The Trans-Caspian pipeline effort collapsed, largely because President Niyazov had unrealistic expectations. Is that a fair way to put it? and at the same time, Shah Deniz was discovered. So from Azerbaijan's standpoint, why should they be a transit country when they could be an exporter of gas to Europe? So what we ended up in those early efforts of the late 90s and early 2000s was an east-west energy corridor, which was the BTC pipeline, bringing oil from Azerbaijan across Georgia to the Mediterranean, port of Ceyhan in Turkey, and the South Caucasus pipeline, which brought a very limited amount, 8 BCM of gas, from Azerbaijan to Georgia and Turkey, but not beyond. And so the concept at that point and the idea at that point was more linked to bringing these countries in the European, moving these countries in the European direction. Now, fast forward from that time to now 10 years, and we had some interesting things happening. 2006 and 2009, cutoffs of Russian gas supplies through Ukraine. And at the same time, plans developing to develop the next phase of Shah Deniz, the Shah Deniz field. So you have a recognition in Europe of a vulnerability that needed to be addressed. At the same time, gas is now available to help meet that need and demand. And so I think the justification has evolved over time. And yes, we're only talking about 10 BCM of gas going to Europe in a market of 500 million or thereabouts. But in a way, that's misleading, because a lot of that demand is in Germany and Italy and developed part of Europe. It's really the real vulnerabilities in European energy security are in the Balkans and Central and Eastern Europe. And even 10 BCM of gas coming into Europe initially through the Southern Corridor can have an impact. And as Joe has mentioned, the Southern Corridor is scalable. And so if you take the existing Southern Corridor, what's under construction, and add to it the Greece-Bulgaria interconnector, perhaps at some point in the future, the Ionian-Adriatic pipeline, then you're bringing gas to those countries that really don't have an alternative source of gas at this point. And for them, 3, 4, 5 BCM of gas is significant in terms of creating competition for them and reducing their dependence on a single supplier.
Let me drill down a little further. As we all know, there have been ups and downs in the relationship between the United States and Azerbaijan at different times over the years. Yet we have remained consistent, whatever the relationship, we have remained consistent over that whole period of time. Why do you think so?
Because I think the underlying goal of linking and drawing these countries in a westward direction remains. And to the extent that these kinds of projects have that impact, and involvement of international companies have impact in bringing more transparency, it's a positive. And so why shouldn't we continue to support these developments?
Okay. Well, you know, we've heard a lot already. I hope you have questions out there. If not, I might call on a few people in the audience. But let's open it up. I see. Do we have a microphone? Or?
Yes.
Yeah. And please identify yourself.
Hi, my name is Mohammed Tahir from Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty. Until July, I was the head of the Turkmen service there. Now I'm in Washington, D.C. My question is that there is still lots of talk in Turkmenistan about possibility of diversifying their energy exports in Europe remains in their agenda. So in this discussion, I'm not hearing any hope that Turkmenistan is also part of this project in any way. And Igna, you mentioned that you used the word down the road maybe possibility. So at this stage, we are not talking about Turkmenistan at all as a part of Southern gas energy corridor.
I'm sure Dan and I'll jump in on this one too.
So the opportunity to bring gas from other resources to fill the Southern Gas Corridor over the, for future decades is absolutely paramount to the success of the Southern Corridor. It's scalable. We need double the gas into the Southern Corridor. The first next cheapest gas will obviously be Azeri gas that goes to the Southern Corridor. And there is absolutely nothing to say that we can't in the future bring Turkmen gas through the Southern Gas Corridor. But at the moment, we see that as still politically very sensitive. There's a lot of politics to be dealt with before that becomes a reality.
By the way, there are some seats up here. You just came in.
Yeah. I would add to that. I would actually take slight issue with an earlier comment, because yes, the Turkmenistan is exporting gas to China right now, but you see what's happening in the Chinese market. Demand is not growing as fast as had been anticipated 3 or 4 years ago. It's not clear that China will take the larger volumes of Turkmen gas that they've talked about in the future. And from a Turkmen standpoint, they're basically becoming so reliant on the Chinese market, as they were for many years on the Russian market, that they're being squeezed on price. The Chinese know that right now for Turkmenistan, there aren't any good options. Russians or Gazprom is no longer buying gas from Turkmenistan. Iran is buying some gas, paying sporadically, and paying in many cases in barter rather than in cash. A lot of the gas that's exported to China from Turkmenistan is repaying the loans to build the pipeline and develop the gas fields. So from a Turkmen standpoint, there naturally would be an interest in accessing another market and providing some competition and not being reliant from their perspective on a single buyer. That said, there are major issues that would have to be overcome. As Ambassador Morningstar knows, we started working on the Trans-Caspian gas pipeline in 1998.
Right.
So it's.
I know Anya wants to comment,
yeah,
but before.
And furthermore, also with Russia looking to the Chinese market, looking to export there, there's, but potentially, now Russia and Central Asia will be competing for the Chinese market. So of course, it would be beneficial for Turkmenistan to diversify its markets. Maybe I put the accents a little bit on the different places, but the fact is that they have already accessed the Chinese market while the Southern Gas Corridor was planned and in discussions for all this time.
I want to go back to Dan to ask you, after all these years, are you changing your tune at all? I mean, you always agreed with me that there would be no Trans-Caspian gas pipeline during my lifetime. Now, I'm getting old, so I'm beginning to worry about that a little bit, or maybe modify it. But the geopolitics of this have been really impossible so far. Whether it be Russia drawing a red line that there could be no Trans-Caspian pipeline. Whether Azerbaijan has always, in my view, been in the position that it could sort of act like a good guy. Sure, if it's built, we'll transit the gas. Not ever thinking that it could ever happen. There have been the boundaries disputes that maybe they would agree to disagree. Turkmenistan's never gotten the kind of guarantees from the Europeans which they can't give. So are you changing your view that this actually might happen in the foreseeable future?
I don't know about your lifetime or my lifetime.
You're only a year younger than me,
right,
so.
But I would say I think the prospects for some Turkmen gas to cross the Caspian are a lot better than they were even 3 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago. Whether it's a large 30 BCM per annum pipeline or something less, I think is a separate question.
Do you see Bertie Mukhametov changing his tune?
I think that the financial situation in Turkmenistan is certainly not great right now. And I think that's a fair statement. And that's a strong motivator.
And what leverage do you think the Russians still have with Turkmenistan? I might even ask our analyst, Bud, to comment on that.
Yeah, I'll leave that one to Bud.
Bud, what do you think? I mean, do you think Bud Coot, who's a senior fellow here and was at the CIA as an analyst for 42 and a half years looking at these issues,
Do you think Russia would allow a Trans-Caspian pipeline?
Yes, I do. I don't think it depends necessarily on your death. I think it's more dependent on
your death.
What happens with Vladimir Putin. I see it possible if Aliyev invites Turkmenistan to send the gas, if Turkmenistan brings in some Western companies to help develop it, and if...
We've been asking them to do that for the last 20 years.
Well, the other condition is that Russia allows it. I think in some ways you can consider the South Caspian Sea another frozen conflict right now. You saw the cruise missiles that the Russian Navy sent from the South Caspian into Syria. Almost all of them made it that far. But I think that was a message to the Caspian states that Russia is there. It has political objections to a Trans-Caspian pipeline, legal objections. And it certainly has military objections, which I think really carry the balance.
So are you agreeing then that it's not likely, or are you saying, I mean, I thought you were beginning to say it was possible, and now you seem to be talking about, you know,
possible,
the Russian red lines.
Possible, but yeah, there are Russian red lines. I think primarily Putin's red lines. I think something would have to change in Russia. Right now, I see more possibility of Turkmen gas getting into Europe through Russia than I do across the Caspian.
All right, because I was, you know, going to ask you, now you, you know, I was, whether you were going to go to Las Vegas and bet your pension, you know, that there would be a Trans-Caspian pipeline, but it sounds like not.
Well, I've just dedicated my pension to investment in the Belene nuclear plant in Bulgaria. Thanks to Ed Chow. But I would very much welcome the panel's reaction to my thoughts.
Just for clarification to those who don't, the Belene nuclear plant is the plant that Russia has had been building in Bulgaria, which has been so controversial for many years now. Anybody want to add anything?
I just, you know, on the Caspian Sea, I mean, another issue is its legal status, whether it's, you know, treated as a lake or as a sea, and that raises implications, how the resources are to be divided and, you know, how where the pipelines can pass through its territorial water. So that's another issue in terms of building the Trans-Caspian.
On that issue, I've always argued, and Dan, I know it's also been the U.S. position, that whatever the legal status of the Caspian, that any pipeline going from Turkmenistan to Azerbaijan would only go through either Turkmen or Azeri waters. So we've always argued it's none of the Russians' business. Now, they would disagree with that, clearly, but...
Well, that's if it's we say it's a lake, and,
right.
I mean, it is a lake, but the Russians say it's undetermined, and therefore this, maintains the conundrum.
Anyway, okay, well, let's, I think we've, okay, I saw Ariel's hand and then Philip.
In 2000 or 2001, I had a paper.
This is Ariel Cohen, by the way.
Ariel Cohen. I had a paper out of the Heritage Foundation arguing that as long as the legal status of the bottom of the Caspian Sea is unresolved, both Russia and Iran will fight the pipeline between Azerbaijan and Turkmenistan. And to remind you, 2000, 2001, the relationship between Russia and the United States was not what it is today. So that prediction held so far, 16 years and counting. I think that as Russia is politicizing now, anything that has to do with the United States and the West, the Turkmen Azeri gas link would be politicized, and both Russia and Iran will oppose it, up to and including using force as they did with the BP geophysics vessel that they chased out from the disputed area in the Caspian. So I wouldn't hold my breath on that. But I have a question to the panel. Again, as Russia and U.S. are politicizing almost every issue in our relationship, and as a relationship between us and Turkey is changing fast, how do you see the completion of this project, and also the top ton up has a potential of expansion? You can put compressor stations, you can pump much more gas than the current 16. So do you think the Russian-Turkish on-again, off-again rapprochement is going to affect it somehow? Do you think if they're really trying to get serious about South Stream, it may be an impediment to Tap-Tanap? Thanks.
We've, in the last 3 or 4 years, as this project's been built, we've heard a lot about Turk Stream and all other sorts of streams coming into Europe. There's one pipeline that's being built at the moment, and that's the Southern Corridor. There's no other pipelines being built. And even in the event that those other pipelines are built, I'll repeat my statement that we have 25 years of gas sales agreement through the pipeline, which bring the 16 BCMA. I do believe there's opportunity in the future to make this scalable, expand the pipeline, TANAP-TAP, bring more gas through the pipeline. And I genuinely encourage competition. And I don't believe that Turk Stream are going to impact the completion of this pipeline by January 2020. Dan,
anybody else?
Yeah, I would say a couple of things. One, if we're talking about initially one line of Turkish Stream, it's basically not new gas. It's just redirecting gas that now comes into western Turkey, Thrace and Istanbul area through the Trans-Balkan line, would now come through Turkish Stream. So it's not enhancing Gazprom's market share in Turkey from that standpoint. If anything, the on-again, off-again relationship over the last 6-9 months between Turkey and Russia is probably a wake-up call for Turkey as well, which has become highly dependent on Russian gas. And I think going forward, maybe looking for ways to not eliminate, because you can't eliminate the large volumes they're now getting from Russia, but looking at other sources, and we know what some of those sources and options are, all of which have some issues attached to them. But I think from a Turkish standpoint, it only makes sense for them to look to diversify their suppliers.
Okay, Philip, you had a...
Thanks very much. I had a question. We were talking a little bit about the difficulty of getting Turkmen gas across the Caspian, but maybe we can talk about gas that's much more likely to at least reach Anatolia, which is Iranian gas. I mean, Zarif was in Turkey last month talking about the increases that were possible in Iranian exports to Turkey. There's obviously an improving relationship there. What do you think are the prospects? Well, and also, let me say kudos to BP for getting their contracts filled on this pipeline, because, I mean, demand increases in Europe don't look to be a very good prospect over the medium term. But what do we see to be, I mean, Turkey is really the place where the demand is. What do we see the prospects of getting the Iranian gas first increased into Turkey, second translated further to Europe, also in terms of just the contracting Iranian gas into Europe?
I mean, I think Iranian gas is, the big question and the big potential game changer, but in the future. I mean, in terms of the infrastructure and the investment, I mean, there's been a lot of talk and interest, but, I mean, as far as I'm aware, nothing really, concrete yet. I mean, the infrastructure is not there. I mean, I think maybe initial... Iranian exports would be in terms of maybe LNG, maybe that's more likely. So I think that's definitely a potential game changer, but not in the near term. But my panelists.
Well, yeah, let me add a little bit to that. you never know, because part of it depends on the political machinations and political decisions that the Iranians would make as to politically, does it make sense to be getting involved in the Southern Corridor and shipping, shipping to Europe. So far, the indication that there have been that that would not be the case, so far. One, the infrastructure needs to be developed. Two, they have their own priorities with respect to gas internally. Three, as you well know, by the way, Philip was an advisor to the chairman of Saudi Aramco before coming back. Three, that there's a huge need for gas within the region that Iran could help supply. And four, LNG routes. And those things seem to have been talked about more than gas to Europe at this point. But yeah, Zarif was in Turkey. They may make different political decisions, but I think to date that has not been the case. Not that it may not happen. Other questions? Tom.
Tom Cunningham, unaffiliated. Sorry. So in terms of European energy security, which is where a lot of U.S. interest has been with regard to the Southern Corridor in recent years, you said that with the, Dan, you said the IGB interconnector is really important for gas from Azerbaijan or in the Southern Corridor to access those parts of Europe that have very little in terms of energy security or in terms of diversification. Is that on track? Is it underway? I guess more pragmatically, what will it take to get it underway? That's the first question. The second question is, when you talk about it being expandable, how does a new dynamic, fast-moving LNG market with floating terminals that are easily installed in the Mediterranean and elsewhere, like the Eni Zohr find or U.S. gas, how does all of that play in terms of other supposedly affordable, supposedly low burden of infrastructure? How do those sources play as well? So two-part question.
On the first part, there's currently a binding open season for booking capacity on IGB, which I think is scheduled to run through mid-October. We'll see what the outcome is, whether that's successful or not. There may be alternatives if for some reason that's not successful to figure out ways to finance the project to make it viable with perhaps some additional funding from the EC. So we'll see. We've certainly encouraged the Bulgarians to move forward on that project along with the Greeks to make it a reality, because it is very significant in terms of the broader impact that the Southern Corridor could have, as in the future, as a project like IAP could be in accessing other countries, particularly in the Western Balkans. I'll defer on the second part of the question to Joe in terms of the LNG, the impact of LNG.
Can you repeat the question? I'm not trying
to be a little more articulate about it. So my question is, thank you. So does the Southern Corridor have a potential, once it's in place, to serve as sort of a backbone of gas infrastructure for South Europe? Mm-hmm. So is it sort of interoperable as the gas supply market is so rapidly evolving? Right. So, is it relevant in a future Europe gas picture?
Yeah, and so I'll go back to my comment on scalability of the corridor. So this is a superhighway throughout Europe. It's scalable to twice the size, and it's scalable actually in very simple terms with extra compression. So it's all about putting extra compression at certain points along the pipeline in order to double the gas flow through it.
Let me ask you this question. Back when Dan and I were working together during the first 3 years or so, well, more than that, I guess, of the Obama administration, the U.S. administration did take a turn from supporting the original Nabucco pipeline that was supposed to deliver 31 BCM to Europe. And we recognized, with the help of our friends, some of whom are in this room, like Greg Saunders and others, that this was not going to happen. There was no way to fill the pipeline. And the sort of in last place at that time was the Trans-Adriatic pipeline. And we basically, and originally, it's funny, I mean, the sponsors of the Trans-Adriatic pipeline originally were counting on getting gas from Iran. You know, the question that you were asking, and, you know, we basically said, no way. But anyway, but, you know, they sort of came around, and we said, you know, we could support, not that our support was the be-all and end-all, but that we could support the Trans-Adriatic pipeline on two conditions. One, that it be scalable, which we've talked about, and two, that some gas get into southeastern Europe, and that that basically would be through the Greece-Bulgaria interconnector, or even at that time talking about a Turkey-Bulgaria interconnector. And BP, to its credit, said, hey, that's great, that's fine with us, we agree, I mean, that should happen. TAP agreed. But it seems like it's been like one issue after another where are we on that, do you think? And is there a likelihood that some of that gas can get into southeastern Europe early on?
We have, as Chardonnay's consortium, have a BCMA of gas set aside to flow through IGB. Hopefully when it is built. So there is a BCMA gas already earmarked for that interconnector. And the Southern Corridor is completely, fully supportive about creating these interconnectors from multiple sources through into the Balkans. And we will endeavor to support that. We are not building IGB, we're not an investor in IGB, but we have the gas set aside to support IGB.
But where do you all, maybe you all can answer it, where do you think that is at this point? Is it real? I mean, it seems like they have such a hard time getting their act together, both countries. Is it going to happen, or?
Again, there's a Chardonnay's has a contract for sale of one BCM.
Yeah, but they can set it aside, but there has to be a pipeline in order for it to go there. Is that pipeline going to happen, do you think?
We're very hopeful that there will be a mechanism to move that one BCM of gas to Bulgaria.
Okay, sounds like some uncertainty to me. Maybe there are people in the audience who are more aware of where things are at this point on that. Anya, nothing. Okay, other questions? Yeah.
The ATNL's operational energy in the Pentagon, and there's been a lot of activity in the Eastern Mediterranean lately, and I want to get the panel's opinion. Is it premature to really get a determination whether this is going to be a European play or predominantly a Middle Eastern play, and will that compete with Southern Corridor, or will it complement it? So just for the panel at large.
I can. I think it's, again, it. Like Iranian gas, you know, it's a possibility of, let's say, the future. But, I mean, present day, the fines, the Israeli fines, the Cypriot fines, and the Egyptian fines, they will first meet the domestic markets, the regional markets. When it comes to exports, it's going to Europe, the big question then is the infrastructural questions. And then, of course, regional political tensions. So there's many questions there. I mean, in theory, the LNG export terminal in Egypt could be used. But there's still a question to what extent, you know, if Israel could potentially use that terminal, and then there's also domestic issues in Israel, regulatory issues, what percentage of their gas they would be willing to export. So that's kind of an ongoing domestic debate.
You have anything there? Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of interesting issues. I mean, one change in the past few months has been that, quote, rapprochement between Turkey and Israel. And a lot of people have claimed that part of that relates to Turkish companies that would like to be involved with the Eastern Mediterranean and possibly a partner with the Israelis which would bring gas into Turkey and maybe on into the southern corridor. There's been so much discussion of an agreement on Cyprus, which would seem to be necessary for Cyprus and Greece to be heavily involved in the Eastern Mediterranean. Will that happen? Will that happen in the upcoming months? There are ocean boundary issues with respect to the various sites. So there really are all sorts of issues, and I've my quote on who better than to quote yourself? My quote on this is, never has there been such great opportunity for so many people and so many countries with so many difficulties as the Eastern Mediterranean. But it'll be interesting to see how it'll work out. One other point that has not gotten as much publicity is Russia's role in the Eastern Mediterranean. And they're playing, as part of their policy, a much more aggressive role in the Eastern Mediterranean. And what about the Russian-Israeli relationship that is extremely close? And particularly with Israel's defense minister being quite close to the Russians, and would Russia would that's a question. I don't know the answer. I mean, so I'm not predicting anything, but would Russia have any influence on Israel's decision on where gas might ultimately go? I don't know, but it's a question that is worthy of consideration. Another area that nobody has raised yet, I don't know if anybody wants to comment on it, is gas from the KRG, the Kurdish area of Iraq, and haven't heard too much about it in the last several months. Anybody have any comments on that, or anybody in the audience? Other questions? Ariel.
You're absolutely right. The Israelis were discussing what percentage of gas they want to export. And the last figure I saw several months ago was 47%, so it's a half. How did they arrive to that number? Nobody knows.
It was a long process.
It was a negotiating process. I happened to be on a panel with the former president of Israel in Baku, and she did not know the first thing about energy. I mean, it was embarrassing what that lady was talking about. Said, well, we'll just pay for education, and we'll pay for social welfare, and we'll pay for medical care, and she was to the left of Elizabeth Warren on that. But in the end of the day, knowing Israel quite well, they'll figure out how to export that gas. Trust me. That gas, unlike KRG or something else, will flow. The other thing is, on Russia, I think it's a very good question. And that is a direct function of the U.S.-Israel relationship. As long as our relationship is strong, they will not let Gazprom in. If our relationship deteriorates, then you'll see Israel hedging its bets with India, with China, with Russia, and everybody else, because they don't feel that we have their back, especially in the case of the last administration. It was up and down, and I don't blame one side. It was equal opportunity disaster. So for now, Netanyahu totally held the line on not letting Gazprom in.
Well, let me ask you, Ariel, this question. I don't know that the panelists would want to answer it, and there's really no answer, but I'll ask the question anyway. What if Trump wins? What happens with, all of these issues that we've talked about today and the relationship with Russia and so on. And maybe there is no answer, but Any thoughts on that?
On the spot.
I think we're on the 12th floor, so if I jump, I won't suffer too much. Who knows?
Yeah, I guess that's the answer.
That's the answer.
That's the scary answer. Who knows?
It's unpredictable. But let me play, let me sort of take it to a logical progression. If Trump improves relations with Russia, and he doesn't sound like an extremely anti-Israel fellow, it'll be a happy ménage à trois in Eastern Mediterranean. That's sort of live happily ever after scenario that I can promote. But given the potential for disaster in that scenario, I'll stop here.
Any other questions? Other questions? We still have time, so. I'll raise another issue. Oh, good, all right, good. I'm glad I didn't have to rescue the question.
Glad to help out. Alan Makovsky, Center for American Progress. I guess two questions. One is, since Eastern Med Gas has been raised, I have to admit, I was a little surprised by how much Netanyahu emphasized the energy relationship with Turkey and justifying the normalization. And it had always been my understanding that Israel and Turkey could only build a gas pipeline either through Syria and Lebanese waters, which, you know, obviously is a non-starter, or through Cyprus's EEZ. And that therefore, and Cyprus has said they would oppose that until there's a settlement of the Cyprus problem. So I was surprised, given that there's been no settlement, notwithstanding the current optimism. I was surprised to see his emphasis. I'm just curious, in your view or the view of the panel, is Cyprus's approval legally necessary for a pipeline through its EEZ? I mean, is there any prospect that they would go forward, these two countries, without the Republic of Cyprus's approval? And secondly, I just wanted to ask on TurkStream. From the, somebody mentioned that if it were just one of the four lines, that there would simply be a replacement for the gas coming to Turkey through the Western route. From Russia's point of view, is that worth it? Is it worth it to build just one line? I'm just curious. Or maybe from Russia and Turkey's point of view.
I can answer that first, if you want. If part of Gazprom's goal is to cut off transit through Ukraine, that's taking, well, last year, the Trans-Balkan line, which serves Western Turkey as well as Greece, Bulgaria, Macedonia, and Moldova. And Romania is not buying any gas, although the line transits through there, carried about 17 BCM of gas. Okay, so if you build one line of Turkish Stream, you can almost replace that and shut down at least that line, which would have an impact, obviously, on Ukraine and the transit revenue they earn. So there's that piece. And if you actually look at how much cost has already been incurred, was initially incurred for a South Stream, which can be used for Turkish Stream, i.e. all the pipe for the first line is sitting in Bulgaria. It's already been ordered and paid for, right? They had a contract to lay the first line with Saipem, which they canceled, which they transferred from South Stream to Turkish Stream, then canceled, and now they're in arbitration. And from a Gazprom standpoint, maybe better to reinstate that contract and use it to finish the Turkish Stream first line than, you know, basically to lose the value through an arbitration. So the marginal cost to Gazprom to complete the first line of Turkish Stream is not that significant as if they were starting from scratch and building just one line.
Also, I will add from Moscow's perspective, I think Turkish Stream is really a political strategic move. I mean, it would strengthen the relationship with Turkey, which is, strategically important in the region and is important for the U.S. It would also maintain that they would get to keep an avenue into Southeast Europe, which is what they really want. So it's and some of it is posturing as well. And again, also as mentioned, the political question with Ukraine, trying to show and move towards trying cutting Ukraine out of the transit business. So.
Anybody want to tackle the exclusive economic zone issue?
I think as Ariel described it, is my understanding that basically would have to be approval by the Cypriots to build a pipeline from the Israeli offshore to Turkey.
It's a generic international maritime law, international public law question. Who has exclusive control over
one's EEZ?
And I don't think that's
China may have a different view of that.
Yeah, I don't think that's been answered yet, that question. Has it? As to whether,
to all my sins, I have not practiced international maritime law.
Yeah. Anyway, but because that issue has come up with respect to Nord Stream 2, and what rights countries have to challenge pipelines going through an exclusive economic zone but not territorial waters. It's it's up in the air.
If it's going through their exclusive economic zone, but not if it's going through international waters, and that's what they did with Nord Stream. They kind of, they didn't do a straight line with Nord Stream. They went a little bit, in little curves to go through the international waters. But just briefly, in terms of Israel's perspective and its gas, it's viewing its gas as a potential tool for regional diplomacy. So, Israel has been exporting bits of gas to Egypt already. It can export gas to Jordan. So they're hoping that this will, help them in the region, in their diplomacy.
Okay, other questions?
So you're saying they wouldn't, because of diplomacy with Cyprus, they wouldn't push that issue?
I'm saying that in the present day, because I was in Israel earlier this year, this was where they were seeing present day versus, I think, the exports to Europe and those types of projects are more, maybe longer term type of considerations, which remain highly uncertain because of the local need, the regional need, and then the infrastructural issues.
Okay. Other questions? Let me raise an issue nobody's talked about yet. I won't put Joe in the middle and ask him the question. Maybe Dan will respond, or some people in the audience. There's been a real debate within EITI, the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, whether countries such as Azerbaijan should be judged only with respect to the transparency in connection with its transactions dealing with companies like BP, other international companies. In fact, they were the first country that qualified for EITI, or whether EITI should go beyond that and look at democracy and human rights issues. And that's being sort of fought out now and could be determined, I guess there's a board meeting coming up this fall sometime. Am I right on that? I think. In any event, so it raises a real question. What effect does that have on international financing, depending on how they come out, like from EBRD? Maybe that's not necessary to the financing of the project. Should EITI be getting involved beyond the extractive transparency issues? And if they do, are they sort of throwing the baby out with the bathwater? They raise some real questions. I'm sure there are some people in the audience who've been concerned with these kinds of issues. And anybody want to comment on any of that? I can give you my view in a second.
I guess we have to hear your view.
No volunteers. all right, I'll give you my
view. Huh? Can you make your view?
All right, my view is that EITI should not get involved beyond what it has historically. And I say that, and will say that nobody can question my credentials on raising democracy and human rights issues in Azerbaijan, if anybody followed what I was doing in Baku, much to the chagrin of some in the government who thought all I was supposed to care about was energy. But, you know, my job was a bigger job at that point. But I don't think that it should, because Azerbaijan has done a reasonable job standing by or complying with the traditional EITI provisions with respect to transparency. And to sort of bring in a whole new part of the game and to throw them out, I think would be counterproductive, and I think would be a mistake. Now, having said that, democracy and human rights issues are obviously issues that, you know, are there in Azerbaijan that the countries have to deal with in their relations with Azerbaijan as an issue in the relationship, and I'm, you know, that will continue. But I don't think EITI should take that kind of action, in my view. Now, are there opposite views here? There must be some people here who would be coming from a different viewpoint. No takers on that? Well, I guess that ends that discussion. I don't think you would disagree with that. You're not answering. but it is an issue that's out there, you know, that I think will get more attention over the coming weeks. Yeah, being from RFERL, let's hear your comment.
Comment and question, actually, you know, the human rights and democracy, transparency, all these are really serious question in Azerbaijan and Turkmenistan on all possible or potential partners in the Caspian region. So in dealing with those countries, striking deals with those countries in a scale, large level, should those values be a matter of discussion? Should those values be a subject or condition to proceed further in dealing with those countries? Or is it already, what kind of conditions should be in place before getting into?
We've worked in Azerbaijan since 1994, and we're confident that what we've brought to the country is beneficial. We comply with international standards and regulations. And we work with our own BP code of conduct and values and behaviors. So what we bring to Azerbaijan and how we work with Azerbaijan is based on clear international transparency and the economic benefit and the development and the social benefits that have been brought to Azerbaijan as a result of that relationship are significant.
And in its dealings with BP, Azerbaijan and SOCAR has acted transparently, I
Absolutely.
Take it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You know, let me respond to the question that you raised. It may be harder, you know, for Dan still being in the government and maybe
no,
Anya
not,
wants
no, 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 no.
Huh?
Not in the government.
Oh, you're a contractor now.
Okay. I'm not, so be clear that none of my views necessarily
reflect the
U.S. government.
Reflect the government.
I'm not an employee of the U.S. government.
Maybe Anya comment on it. And again, I'm one who certainly has spoken out about these issues very loudly at times. I don't think that it should affect the energy relationship, as long as the companies are acting, you know, in an appropriate way. And the reason I say that is that I don't think that walking away from energy relationships, whether it be in Azerbaijan or in most other places, is going to improve democracy and human rights. I think it might actually have a negative effect and arguably could make things even worse. And the fact is that by the development of the energy relationship in a country like Azerbaijan, one can argue it should have helped the people of Azerbaijan more, but it's certainly better, I think, than if it had not happened. And again, the issues are important issues and have to be dealt with, but I think they should be dealt with in another way. And because I don't think it would be, I don't think it would be incrementally productive to condition energy relationships on a democracy and human rights record if it's not going to improve the situation. And I don't think it would, might even hurt the situation. But at the same time, it's the responsibility of governments and others to raise the issues, but I would argue not in this context. You know, maybe I have spent too many years dealing with energy, but that's where I would come out on it. But you know, we have a few minutes left. If anybody wants to challenge that, and there were days when I woke up when I would say, "Wait a second," you know. So, but anyway, yeah, back.
Hello, my name is Vukar Gurbanov. I'm from Azerbaijan Embassy. Thank you very much for this event. First of all, I would like to raise my objections to mixing democracy and energy issues. Obviously, Azerbaijan government invested lots of money into the social and economic development, and by that, human rights issue has enormously progressed. And the second issue, I just wanted to ask a question on some fields in the Caspian Sea, south of Caspian, which is claimed by Iran. Any exploration, any plans, or any comments on that? Thank you.
I haven't any line of sight to what's happening in the south of the Caspian in the Iranian fields.
You need a microphone.
Said it's Emily Meredith with Energy Intelligence. And Joe, you mentioned that for the expansion, the first cheapest gas is Azeri gas, right? But there are concerns that, you know, there are some doubts now that there might not be as much Azeri gas as initially thought when the expansion was contemplated. So what are your thoughts on that?
No, I disagree with that. I think there's plenty of resources in the Caspian and the Azeri Basin that can be developed. Some of them fairly short term, and some of the longer term plays like the deep gas plays. So the Caspian, Azerbaijan part of Caspian is rich in reserves. The difficulty is, of course, in the current low oil prices, how you make the development of those fields economic. But there is reserves there to be developed. So, yeah, we would need to look for the quickest gas to market. So Azerbaijan, government of Azerbaijan, BP and SOCAR are in debate about those the whole time. There's all sorts of options to bring gas quickly through to the southern corridor.
I think there's also an infrastructure, physical infrastructure limitation in terms of rigs that are available.
Because it's less, yeah.
So that's just something that has to be overcome.
But SOCAR are just in the end stages of completing building a new rig as well, which bring an extra rig into the Caspian Sea.
Yeah, you're good.
Last chance. Okay, I think we actually have come pretty much to the end of the time, and it's late. Thank you for all of you for participating. Thank you for the audience, to the audience. And let's give a round of applause to our panel.
This was interesting. So many different nuances.